Thank you for inviting me to talk about breast cancer in the Asian community today. It's a subject that's near and dear to my heart. I spend my days at the office. I'm in private practice in Brooklyn and in Manhattan, and I spend my days trying to educate my patients on what they need to do to prevent cancer. My father had lung cancer, and I have a very strong family history of colon cancer and other cancers. My cousin just died of brain cancer last year. So, you know, what makes me frustrated about the Asian community in general is how little they know and how many myths there are and where they're getting their information from. So I'd like to spend some time dispelling some of those myths today, if I can. So basically, thank you for the introduction. My background is in the ACOG. I was also in resident education for 13 years, because so education is a very big piece of what I do. I've always believed in community service and outreach, and I want to thank ACS for inviting me tonight. I'm a president of ACAP, which is also one of our missions, is community organization that reaches out to its community. We do hepatitis B screening. We were involved in colon cancer screening. We do this in all three boroughs of Queens, Manhattan, as well as in Brooklyn. I work with the Indo-Chinese Sino-American group. I work with APICHA, the Asian Pacific Islander group. I've also spoken to the Japanese Medical Society at NYU. ACS actually invited me out there 2 years ago to talk about cervical cancer screening at that time. So we're going to move on a little bit. Just a real general broad overview. Now, this applies to the United States cancer rates, keeping in mind that this is obviously different worldwide. And this is of all women, so they're not breaking this particular slide down by ethnic groups. So as you look at women, which is what we're going to be focusing on, obviously lung cancer is still number one. And then we have breast cancer, and then, you know, in declining incidence, okay, of deaths. This is about cancer death. All right. We know that ovarian cancer is extremely lethal. Even though uterine cancer is the most common GYN cancer, but it's not the most lethal cancer. Okay. So the mortality, these are rates from 2007, and where we see cancer in here is ranking number two. How we know, however, in Asian women, cancer is the number one cause of death. We don't die of heart disease as much as we die of cancer, and I would probably guess that part of that is incidence, a little bit of genetics. I think we get breast cancer about a decade younger than our Caucasian counterparts, but also because of the late stage that they present to me. Very often I get patients who believe that the only cause to go to a gynecologist is to have a baby. So if you're not having a baby, then why should I go get a checkup? You know, I had a mammogram ordered by my internist, that's good enough. But they forget that mammography misses about 10% of cancer, and that alone is not enough. So basically the guidelines remain, then you get an annual mammogram starting at age 40. I do it every year on my birthday, so I can still remember to do that. Because we know the insurance companies often make you wait 365 days. If you are going to do it in between because you have a mass, it's an indicated mammogram. That's called a diagnostic mammogram. Screening mammography is when you have no symptoms and you don't feel anything. That's a screening test. But you're allowed to go do it sooner, so don't be afraid of whether it's going to get covered. If you feel something, you go get it checked out. If your doctor orders a mammogram earlier than you think you should, it's actually because it's diagnostic. It's okay. We do clinical breast exams. I still think that it should be part of the annual examination, and I usually start training my girls to do it in their 20s, so they start to get familiar with it, and also because mammography and breast ultrasound don't work so well in dense young breast tissue. And definitely during pregnancy, the tissue is extremely dense, so palpation is the only thing that's really going to be able to pick things up early on, because you don't usually do mammography during a pregnancy. And by the early 20s, women need to know, you know, how to do a proper breast exam, what's the function of a breast, what's the anatomy, so they know what normal for them is, you know. This is the prevalence percent by educational attainment. So the women with no health insurance, women with less than a high school education, tend to get screened less often. So we want to target those women as well, the ones that don't have access and don't have as great an education. They may not be aware, they may be ignorant of what are the benefits. So today's objective is to go with some breast basics. We're going to talk a little about anatomy, a little bit about function, some of the disease entities. People are sometimes so worried about these little fibroadenomas that don't grow. They stay the same size year after year after year, and every 3 to 6 months they're getting ultrasound. Those are not so likely to become cancerous, right? So we'll talk about that. What's the screening? Treatment and prognosis, I'm only going to gloss over. All right. So when you look at, this is a long list of breast cancer non-familial risk factors. In other words, these are things that are not related to your genetics. Obesity, for instance, previous cancer in one breast. 99% of breast cancers are women, for instance. Cold climate over warm climate. Some very strange things. But obesity, hypertension with diabetes, threefold increase in risk over there. All right? And then white versus Asian, 5-1. However, we do seem to get it a little bit younger, which means that it may be more aggressive and it's not, and it may be an estrogen-dependent breast cancer. And we know that having a child before the age of 30 is also considered protective as well. So this is your breast basic, right? It's a modified sweat gland, we're always told. These are the lobes, and this is sometimes when you're examining a patient, what you feel are kind of smooth, a little bit mushy. Those are fat lobules very often. And you'll feel sometimes like this pulling sensation. There's ligaments underneath here. And you have to remember below the breast tissue is also muscle, and underneath your muscle are ribs. So when you feel this hard thing over your chest, this is actually your rib. And sometimes it's going to be tender because you can get arthritis over here as well. So people are always worried that this is, you know, a breast cancer over here, but it could just be arthritic. All right. These are the mammary ducts. We have about 20 ducts, and for the purpose of breastfeeding, that lead to the nipple. So if you've had previous breast surgery, if you had implants placed, depending upon if they're under the muscle or over the muscle, it may or may not, the scar tissue, impact on breastfeeding. All right. The nipple, if it's inverted all of a sudden when it's always been outside, that's something to be concerned about. If there's a nipple discharge and you're not breastfeeding, that's something you need to go see your doctor about. If there's a change in the way the skin texture is, that's another thing that you should come in and see us about. All right. So we'll talk a little bit about the discharge. If it's milky discharge, what can that mean? Well, it could be pregnancy, right? You could leak during pregnancy. It could be postpartum. It could be also a brain tumor called pituitary adenoma. If that's also associated with abnormal periods where your periods are coming every 2 to 3 months, that's also something that needs to get worked up. There'll be some blood testing. Might end up having to get an MRI done of the brain if we find that your prolactin levels are high. You can have green, yellow, sticky discharge. This is benign, the ductal ectasia. That's kind of where there's a little bit extra tissue growing inside the duct. It's not that common. Clear and watery can be ductal carcinoma, and we worry about pink serosanguinous, and we definitely don't really like bloody sanguinous either. So all of those things are reasons to go see your doctor about. Don't stay home and guess. Conditions that don't increase the risk of breast cancer, adenosis, ductal ectasia, these are all things that are really benign. When we say, oh, you have fibrocystic breasts, that's all right. All right, but that means that we've probably ruled everything else out. Fibrosis, mild hyperplasia. Mastitis is a fancy word to say inflammation of your breast. Periductal mastitis. These are all benign if you see these on the biopsy results. These are slightly higher risk because this means that the tissue is starting to grow. Papilloma needs to be watched if that was what the biopsy results. Moderate or florid hyperplasia. We definitely don't like the word atypia. When we see atypia in the uterus, if we see atypia in the breast, we say atypia in the colon. These are things that require much closer follow-up because that means you have a 3- to 5-fold increase risk of getting breast cancer. So the word atypical usually implies that there could be a progression to cancer. So atypical colonic polyps, all of those things make me do surgery usually. Familial tendency to cancer, well, if your mother or your sister, which are first degree relatives, that's a first degree, then you have a 2.3 increased relative risk. That's what RR stands for. Your aunt or your grandmother is a second degree because they're now the next line, right? That's 1.5. Then we have an affected mother and a sister. Now you've got two first degree relatives. That's 14-fold increase in relative risk. Well, these are breast disorders, developmental anomalies, fibrocystic changes. These are just all variations of fairly benign. Benign means negative, safe, not cancerous. People ask me all the time, well, what's the difference between a tumor and a cyst? Tumors and cysts can be the same things. So a tumor can be benign and can also be malignant. A cyst just describes a circular kind of an entity, which can also be benign or good. These are developmental. In other words, when you were born, these are things that were from birth. Congenital meaning at birth. Absence usually associated with the deformities of the muscles and bones of the chest wall. In other words, your breasts didn't form. Sometimes you have one side that's much larger than the other, and you can have accessory breast tissue. You can actually have women with multiple nipples. They actually have a nipple line that goes straight up. You can also have it underneath the armpit. Some women come in and they notice during pregnancy that something underneath their arm is starting to grow. Sometimes that's actually breast tissue that's growing a little bit further. These are just fibrocystic changes. We use this term very often. We throw it around. And fibrocystic changes are really just when the texture of the breast is a little bit increased. And sometimes it's the ligaments. Sometimes it's due to caffeine, changing hormonal environment. Sometimes it's when women gain 3 pounds or 5 pounds or lose 5 pounds, it can change. The peak age of this is around 30 to 50 years old. You also find that it tends to increase a little bit just before your period, and then it tends to get a little bit better after your period is over. Some people feel that progesterone plays a role. And we treat this sometimes with hormone therapy, tamoxifen. We usually don't use tamoxifen, but it can be considered a treatment. We used to use bromocriptine, which is something we use to promote milk letdown, actually to reduce the galactorrhea. Milk production. Androgens, progesterone, danazol, controlled caffeine intake. Some people try evening primrose oil. That works for some, doesn't work for others. Okay, when we see somebody with a nipple discharge, what do? We look at the color, we note that. Is it both? Is it spontaneous? In other words, does it just happen without you doing anything to stimulate it from coming out? Like, did you just notice it on your bra one day? That's a spontaneous discharge. Or is it every time you express, try to squeeze the nipple, that you actually see this discharge? That's a little bit different too. Is it bloody? Is it clear? Is it milky? So when you're bringing this up with your doctor, these are the descriptive terms we want to hear. Galactorrhea, when we actually stain it with a special stain, we'll see fat lobules, and that's how we know that it's milk, because milk has fat in it. Is it just one side? Is it both sides? Mastitis just means inflammation of the breast, and then we want to know, is it during the time when you're breastfeeding, or is it outside of pregnancy? Are you like 2 years away from when you were last pregnant? So that's a little bit different as well. We often see mastitis postpartum after a baby's delivered because the milk gets backed up and they get all red, and then sometimes they become an abscess. The treatment for that is usually just warm compresses and continue to pump if you're breastfeeding, and antibiotics if the skin gets infected. Non-purpural is a fancy word for saying not pregnant, not associated with pregnancy. All right, so also it can have a discharge that's associated, and usually what we do is we remove that duct that's backed up, and we send it out to make sure it's okay. So there's something inside the breast, one of those lobules that might be infected. This is a surgeon's world. We send this out to the general surgeon. For the most part, most breast masses are treated by general surgery. That's my personal preference. I know there are some interventional radiologists that like to do fine needle aspirations. They'll do something called an ABI. I tend to be a little, you know, between, but if that's abnormal, then they send it to the general surgeon anyway. So sometimes it's a team approach of the radiologist and the general surgeon and the gynecologist all together. These are all benign. Lipoma means fat. Adenoma is just like a fibroid, just like that one is. This is just superficial, the blood vessels. Mondor's disease is when there's just inflammation of the blood vessels on the surface, because you can see those little green veins that are on there. They can get inflamed. Fat necrosis, I've had patients come in and they were elbowed in the breast, or someone threw a baseball and they got hit in the chest for some reason, and they end up with the fat tissue actually it explodes, the little fat cells, and so they end up getting an inflammation. So what do we do when we get a breast mass in the office? Well, we can feel it, first of all. Then if it's mobile and it's less than 2 centimeters and it's close enough to the surface, I'll take a needle and I will try to aspirate it to see if it's solid or cystic. If it's cystic, then I want to know what color is the water. Well, if the water is clear or cloudy, then and the mass completely disappears, I throw away the fluid and I bring them back. I usually bring them back in 3 months. If I take out that water and then the mass continues to stay there, then I'm going to probably send them for a mammogram and a breast ultrasound, and probably to a breast surgeon to follow that. The very least that I will do is bring them back again in 3 months. I don't really like to wait 6 months on a breast mass. I think it's a little bit too far away. And if you're still a menstruating woman, I'll bring you back after your period is over. You know, if you come in for an exam just before your cycle, very often it's a little bit more tender and a little bit more cystic. So I want to see what you look like after the next one. And then if the fluid is very abnormal, there's some blood, it's green, Then off to the surgeon for me, you go. But in general, you need a mammogram, breast ultrasound, depending upon your age. But I usually bring in a colleague at this point to get a second opinion. This is part of the diagram. This is a diagram on how to screen. I happen to like doing this lying down. I think it's easier because the chest wall is flat. One arm goes up, and it's the opposite hand that goes to do the examination. Right? You can't really use your same hand because it's awkward. So the opposite one, and every single time you do this, if you do it the next month, you do it in the same position again. Don't put your arm out this way 1 month and then this way in another month because the anatomy is going to change. And so you kind of always want to do it at the same time, like always the week after your period. That would be the best. If you don't have a period, I tell people, well, remember the first of the month or when you're going to pay your bills. That's when you're going to do it. If you don't pay your bills, then that's a different story. Then pick an arbitrary day and you just do it on that. Okay? All right. This is a mammogram machine. It's now digital, so it's not less painful than it used to be. And you get a lot, and instantly you'll know whether or not they need to get the film. So there's less of this going home, getting called back. You know, if you have I usually prefer a radiology office that has the radiologist there. I really don't like places where the technician only is there, and then, you know, you go home. Technician, the doctor reads the films that night, and then you get this letter the next day that says you need to come back for another film. Patients get a little bit nervous. I usually prefer, you know, radiologist reading it immediately. If you need another film, you do another film. By law, you should be getting your lab results in the mail about your mammogram. Usually it says it's benign, normal 1 year follow-up, or you need another view, and that should be a letter that goes to you directly. The gynecologist, or if I'm the one who orders it, I will get a copy of the results. So will your internist, all right? But the radiologist should be sending you some information about this. Now, as far as treatment is concerned, that really depends on whether or not you're diagnosed with cancer, okay? If you are diagnosed with cancer, it's going to depend upon whether or not you have a strong family history. Maybe you might be going for genetic counseling. If you find that you have one of the BRCA antigens as positive, you possibly may be going for a double mastectomy. You know, these are things that you're going to talk to with your surgeon. I purposely left this blank because it could be lumpectomy. It depends on if there's any more masses on the other side. The treatment sometimes even includes removing the ovaries. Some people, if they're postmenopausal, may only get a radiation therapy afterwards. Premenopausally, we tend to see chemotherapy and radiation being used. You know, so we end up getting a lot more aggressive with our premenopausal patients because with the breast cancer and premenopause, usually you have time for the cancer to come back because you're so young. If the young life expectancy is 70-something, you know. So the treatment, again, depends on the type of tumor, what your family history is, what's the size of this tumor, is it stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, and then whether or not, and what your overall health condition is. Can you stand surgery? Do you have a heart condition that where you can't have a prolonged surgery? Maybe you don't tolerate chemotherapy. You know, so you have to, those are all things that we think about. And the prognosis is related to age and stage. You know, these are things that are individual. So I didn't put that in because, again, everything is about ratios and guessing. If I say you have a 90% chance of doing well, you know, then hopefully you're just the 90. But that means there's a 10% out there also. Or, you know, people ask me all the time, what's the percent chance that I might have cancer? If I tell you 1 in 9, you know, are you the 1 or are you the 9? You know, so the best thing to do is just do the screening that you should, do it early, colon cancer at 50, earlier if you have anybody in your family with a history of colon cancer, let's say at 40, you subtract 10 and you start at 30. You have to get your screenings for your heart disease. So colon cancer, stomach cancer, these are Asian cancers. Think about hepatitis B and its relationship to liver cancer, nasopharyngeal carcinoma. What about that sniffle that never goes away? You know, are you someone from Southeast Asia that had a lot of nitrates, you know, those salty fishes that we've eaten? Those are all things that increase the nasopharyngeal carcinoma. So you have to know your risk factors. If your stomach constantly hurts, you should get an endoscopy. Maybe you have a bacteria, H. pylori, that causes stomach cancer. So the point of tonight was to point out basically the anatomy, what are the risk factors, what's a benign breast condition, what is a cancerous condition. Are there any questions, or do you have any questions? Or no? Good? Okay. So I think we covered the topic, and I'm going to leave this to Kate now.
Right now, I would like to proceed to telling you about one of our upcoming events, Making Strides Against Breast Cancer. Making Strides Against Breast Cancer is an annual breast cancer walk American Cancer Society does. It's a nationwide event. We walk in October, which is the Breast Cancer Awareness Month, and I'm really glad that we have Dr. Ng here today to kick off the Breast Cancer Awareness Month with us. So right now we're going to play a short video to show you what this walk is about and how you can get involved. And further on, I will talk a little bit about how you can participate in this walk and make a difference with us.
We are mothers.
We are grandmothers.
We are your children.
We are family.
We are a movement.
We will stand together.
And we are determined.
We are determined.
We are the future.
We are the future.
We are not afraid.
Not afraid.
Not afraid.
We are tough.
We are powerful.
We are brave.
We are strong.
Strong.
Fuerte.
We are strong.
We are not afraid. We are many.
We are many.
We are many.
Many.
We are many.
We are one.
One.
We are one.
We are an army.
We are an army.
Army.
We will unite.
We will unite.
We will unite.
We will fight.
We will fight.
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 We will fight.
We will win.
We will win.
We will win.
Vamos a ganar.
We will win.
We will win.
We will win.
We are hope.
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 Hope starts with us. With us.
So as you can see, this is how the breast cancer walk looks like. And you know, it takes place on October 17th. It's a beautiful Sunday, hopefully. And at multiple sites in Manhattan, we walk at Central Park. In Queens, we walk at Queensboro Hall. In Brooklyn, we walk at Prospect Park. And also in Long Island, we walk at Jones Beach. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about how we can get involved and why we should get involved. So what is Making Strides Against Breast Cancer? I already talked a little bit about it. It's an annual breast cancer walk sponsored by American Cancer Society. It's a community event that has began since 1993. And this year, we're walking in 22 different locations throughout New York and New Jersey. And you can definitely find out how you can participate later. And this is really an event we really want to do to raise the breast cancer awareness in the community, and also to raise money towards our breast cancer research, breast cancer treatment, breast cancer prevention services. So why should you help? I believe Dr. Ng has already mentioned, you know, how breast cancer can affect everyone. It's not just women, though it's more prevalent in women. Men is also at equal risk. In the United States, approximately 1 out of 4 cancers diagnosed in women is breast cancer. And you know, early detection is really, really an important key to prevent breast cancer. As Dr. Ng has mentioned, that mammography is a very effective and the most recommended way nowadays. And it is recommended by American Society that women above 40 years old should get their annual mammogram. And whoever has a family history of breast cancer should definitely start early. And if breast cancer is found early, usually 96%, you know, can be treated and has a good prognosis. A recent study actually tells us that mammography accounts for about 1/3 of reduction in death from breast cancer. So, you know, we definitely stand by our guideline that, you know, please, if you haven't got your mammogram today, if your mother hasn't got her mammogram this year, please go back, tell them, tell your aunts, tell your sisters, tell your loved ones. Together, we can really, you know, make a difference in eliminating or preventing this cancer from, you know, further attacking our community. And also, it was 2 days ago, a Swedish study says that mammography screening reduces the risk of death in women in their 40s. So there is scientific evidence that, you know, this is effective, and we can all participate in this, you know, walk in terms of promoting awareness and also raising money towards the services we provide free of charge to those uninsured and underinsured women in our community. So how can you participate? First of all, form a team. You can form a team online or form a team offline. And then recruit your friends, family, co-workers. I talk to everyone I see. Dr. Ng and Anthony has been definitely getting my emails over and over again regarding this walk. And then fundraise. Most importantly, come out to walk with us on October 17th. This is just, you know, some photos I would like to show you how, you know, my student interns over the summertime, they have been trying hard, and also all the team captains, all the teams have been, you know, fundraising with us and promoting breast cancer awareness with us. We go to the Myanmar Chinese American Water Festival in Chinatown. We went to a breast cancer awareness day, and also Dr. Ng gave a presentation the day off as well. We went to Dragon Boat Festival. We had our kickoff at New York Hospital, Queens. We're all over the place because everyone, you know, really, really needs to get involved, and you know, you can contribute too. This is at a university local-wise, and their sorority group held a nail fundraiser. They paint, you know, colleagues nails pink to raise their awareness. They did my nails too. So yeah, and the other point I would like to highlight is not only by raising money you can make a difference, you can also be recognized, you know, with a national honor. A pay setter is an individual raises $2,500 at the breast cancer walk, and you can get acknowledged at our Making Strides event on the day off, and also you will be recognized and appreciated on our Making Strides nationwide website. You will get a recognition appreciation letter from our CEO Don Distasio, and also you get a chance to go on a paysetter cruise next spring with us, sponsored by H&M. So how can you get involved? Visit our Making Strides page today, which is makingstrides.acsevents.org/Asian Initiatives. So on this webpage, you'll be able to see that, like I said, we will be walking at different sites throughout New York and New Jersey. Click on one site you like to walk at, and then sign up or simply donate. Please search for Asian Initiatives office if you like to make a donation to support our community to make a difference with us. So you can either donate to a walker if your friend is walking, or donate to a team, which is Asian Initiatives office. And if you do wish to, you know, go above and beyond becoming a team captain and walk with us, please remember to select Asian Initiatives department when you sign up as your team company. And from there, you can actually use all different kinds of social media network to help spread the word for us. One feature we have this year is the Facebook widget. You can easily link it on your Facebook and let your friends know that you're doing something good for the community. So, last but not least, I would like to invite you all to come out and walk with us again October 17th. It's a Sunday. We walk at different sites, and I definitely look forward to seeing you all there. Thank you very much. Does anyone have any questions for me or Dr. Ng?
Question related to whether or not I have any statistics, in particular about Asian women in New York City. And the answer is no. I probably would have to speak to AAF, AFNI, maybe to try and see if we can get some statistics together. But there's a lot of research and interest in Asians in particular, in Southeast Asians, and the age of onset of breast cancer. We're doing a cancer study right now. We're calling it ABC, actually, Asian Breast Cancer Study. How funny. A tissue banking breast biopsies with New York Hospital, Queens. You know, I think that One of the challenges of being a Chinese doctor in New York and taking care of many Asians is I realize a lot of the statistics don't necessarily apply. And I find myself struggling when I have a woman who's in front of me and I'm trying to apply these studies and statistics to them, and I don't know how much. I know I see them younger. I know I see that that they're maybe not as often, but certainly more aggressive, you know, and that they have. I had a 26-year-old boy that died of colon cancer, you know, at the hospital once. And who would think a 26-year-old boy should ever die of colon cancer, and who's Chinese, you know, when I worked in general surgery. So we need a lot more information about cancer in the United States among Southeast Asians, I would say. And part of the problem is that we don't get a lot of participation in research with Asians. You know, or any minority group for that matter. You know, African Americans have the Tuskegee experience that prevents them, you know, from trusting us to do research. And Asians in general have difficulty battling with cancer and discussing cancer in their own families with the stigma. You know, I have family members in California who won't talk about their cancer. They don't want to tell us. They don't even want to tell their children what they had. So how do you, if you don't know what you have, how do you study it? How do you know what the incidence truly is if people don't talk about it? So part of this is our own bias, you know, it's actually a study bias of Asians not participating, not talking about it. And then physicians also just not discussing it, you know, we don't push and push and push. I find that if I nag my patients long enough, sooner or later they give in because they just don't want to hear from me any longer, you know, but whatever it takes. Did that answer your question? That was a very long question. Sorry, the answer to your short question. There is Memorial Sloan Kettering. The question is, where is there a centralized source? Memorial Sloan Kettering has a minority division that does its best to try and do this and outreach, but there's maybe this electronic medical record world may answer this. But at the end of the day, the patient owns the data, right? And so if they don't want to share their data, you won't get the data. But then that also supposes that the patients are going to go get tested to get diagnosed. You know, so if all of those pieces aren't in place, if you look at root cause analysis, you know, if the patient doesn't go to the doctor, if the doctor doesn't ask the right question, if they don't get into the right place to get the tissue bank, and then they're not aware that there's a centralized need to study, to draw bloods, to find a gene, to find, then all of it falls apart. So all of the data that we present to you is meaningless if it's not true data. If you're not getting real statistics and real numbers. So you'd actually have to have all women getting screening, all women with, you know, and making sure that they don't have, or men, for whatever the cancer is. So everybody has to participate, you know, and then everybody has to agree to have their data shared. And then there has to be some kind of centralized tissue banking, some kind of centralized blood test, where if I have three sisters, I had a patient who had three sisters with breast cancer and their gene test was negative, but she had one of the strongest family histories I've ever seen of cancers. So that tells me maybe we don't have the right gene for Chinese, you know? So there's a lot more work that needs to be done, but without the proper funding, we're not gonna get it. But even if you fund it and they don't come, what good is it? Okay. So thanks for asking that question. Maybe we can get people to participate. in research, because, you know, it's great that we're doing all of this stuff and that, you know, ACS does what they can, MSK, is Memorial Sloan Kettering, is doing what they can, Dr. Carol Brown in particular. But it's very frustrating for me to try and get, I maybe get 40% of my patients to get a mammogram, and then to get them to do it every year when they're hearing, oh, it causes breast cancer, or I had a mammogram once, it was normal. That's enough, you know, and they think that after 70, I don't need to get one anymore. You know, they have all of these myths that need to get dispelled, and I don't know how to do it anymore, you know, other than to talk about it, tell everybody, tell the media, tell the newspaper, tell one patient at a time. I don't know. We just, you know, it needs to get out there. You know, if I could, it would, except for... And it could be. If I had my patients in the room and I could just force them to get their breast, you know, get mammogram, that would be great. Except for the fact that I'm not a radiologist. And to do a mammogram requires lead-lined walls. And you have to have the right facility. And more places are not doing mammography because they're getting sued, quite frankly. And they're also underfunded. They're not reimbursed well. So if it's a procedure that people get sued for and it's not paid well and they lose money with every time they perform the procedure, how much intelligence does it take to figure out whether what's in it for a radiologist to want to continue to do this? You know, that's part of it. We need to pay, reimburse your doctors properly to do the procedure and then to, you know, make it a safe and sensitive procedure. In other words, that it should pick up breast cancer. But people also have to realize 10% of breast cancers are missed by mammogram, so you still have to get a clinical breast exam. Mammogram, ultrasound alone are not enough. You have to do the breast exam. Breast exam alone is not enough. My fingers are good, but they're not magical. You still have to go get the mammogram. You know, some people think, oh, you examined me. I felt fine. I don't need a mammogram. You need to put it all together. Besides family history, I would say, aside from just the regular, when I'm screening, I'm thinking you have no risk. Let's say you also have a family, strong family history. I'm going to look at that cancer gene testing as an added modality. I'm going to maybe bring in a breast surgeon for you to go check. Like, I'll say, okay, you see me every May, see a breast surgeon every November, so that every 6 months someone is checking you. Because even if you're completely, I get patients all the time, mammogram, everything was negative today, 8 months later she's got a breast cancer. It can happen. Which is why you really can't afford to skip a year. You know, so even if you developed breast cancer between the time I see you, it won't be 2 years before I see you. You know, I definitely have patients every year that it just took too long. All right, but fortunately, women are surviving better because these chemos must be doing better, because I don't lose a lot of patients ever from breast cancer. Fortunately, really, in 20 years, I have to say breast cancer really has actually made a lot of strides. That's probably one of the ones that we're actually making an impact on. I'd like to see ovarian cancer in the same place, but actually the survivability of that even is getting better. Early detection is the key to everything. Oh, I would say Caucasians and African-American women, you know, need to get our higher prevalence. You know, if we get it young, it's more aggressive. You know, even ovarian cancer, which is much less in incidence, you have a 1 in 80 chance of getting ovarian cancer, but you have a higher chance of dying of ovarian cancer. You see the difference? So incidence and aggressiveness are not necessarily the same thing.
They don't necessarily has as high prevalence as the Caucasians. However, I think Chinese women in particular, they have breast cancer at a younger age. So that's
not just Chinese. I would say Japanese as well as Filipinos. I would say that it's a Southeast Asian.
Right.
Because I think we just...
In general,
Southeast Asian, I would say. I wouldn't say South Asian as much as Southeast Asian. I don't have the statistics on Bangladeshi or Pakistani necessarily, so I really can't comment to that unless you are aware of a decade difference. But again, these are just all suspicions, and it's more data out of Asia itself that points towards a younger age.
Right.
But what happens to them when they come to the United States,
right,
it's a little bit different,
yeah,
I think.
Acculturation might be another risk factor. Right.
The meat eating, the learning how to eat like an American, you know.
So I think that's really the key is early detection and prevention.
I always tell people, you know, why would you want to be responsible for finding your own breast cancer? Come to the office and let me be responsible for it. Otherwise, you're sitting at home wondering, am I at risk? Do I have this? Is there something? You know? So I would say that just make it all women. You know, 1% of breast cancers are male. You know, so if there's a suspicious breast mass over there, men need to get checked. They're the worst, you know, for everything. They need to get checked. They don't get checked for anything. The education is getting better. The drum is getting beat. Definitely, you know, through ACS Eastern Division, being aware that newspapers, we're learning where the media is involved here. Newspapers are a very major source for the Chinese. Testimonial is the one. The radios help. You know, I would say that the major newspapers have interviewed me, you know, often. We try to partner up with community organizations, religious organizations. Anybody who will invite me to speak, I'm out there talking to. I think access has a lot to do with it. Again, radiologists. I can say you go to a mammogram place, but if they, a lot of the Asians want to be able to walk in and get it done the minute they think they want to get it done. The idea of getting an appointment and then going in 3 weeks is difficult. So access, you know, and having it available 24/7. So many people work in a restaurant, let's say, and they don't get out till midnight. When are they going to get a mammogram done? Then my older ones are, they can't get away because they're babysitting their grandchildren. And then nobody will, you know, let them out. They have to go pick up the kids, you know, they can't. So access is the issue. I think it's Obamacare. The mistake is to mistake that being insured equals getting health care, but it doesn't. Access doesn't have to do with insurance. You know, I wish that it would have been free clinics put up instead of giving people insurance, because I have very well insured patients that do not go to the doctor and don't get screened. People with insurance all the time don't get checked, like most males. No, just kidding.
Good question. Thank you. On the day off, unfortunately, we don't have the capacity. However, if you qualify for the New York State Cancer Service Program, which is provided for women who are above 40 years old, uninsured or underinsured, qualify for the low income level and haven't had a mammogram for the past year, you can feel free to contact ACS to set up a free mammogram. If you know there's an event going on in your community, we're more than happy to refer you to the right sources. We not only take care of, you know, Chinese, Koreans or Japanese, you know, we take care of all women in the community. So welcome to contact us.
South Asian community. All right. Well, I would say that I think you might have to elicit the Indian Medical Association, the ethnic medical associations that are associated. I think with them also, it's the same thing. It's about trust and also communication and barriers. So putting people in their neighborhoods, getting the pharmacies involved, I would say the restaurants, you know, we're all very social, family-oriented groups, Southeast and South Asians. And I think maybe advertising locally to their community leaders is helpful, and their newspapers, you know, because if they can't understand the mainstream media, where do you think they're going to get their information? Through their newspapers, you know, through websites, not so much, because that also assumes that people have access to a computer. So I would say that these street fairs help in their neighborhood. I think health fairs help. Reaching out to the faith-based organizations that they, you know, subscribe to, getting the churches involved and the religious leaders are helpful. And also the hospitals that are over there in their neighborhoods are helpful. You know, I know that there's a lot of there's an Indian Medical Association, there's a Pakistani Medical Association, and those are good to reach out to, you know, besides the Arabic Association, the Hellenic Medical Society. So we're trying to see if we can partner up with ethnic medical associations, you know, because you have to remember at the end of the day, it's the patient and the doctor, you know. So I need, you know, a doctor's going to have to do the referral.